Good morning, good morning. Welcome to Kollel Ahavat Israel, Partners in Torah Foundation. I want to first and foremost thank you all for joining us and also for promoting our class as usual every Tuesday b'Shabbat Kodesh, twice as good. We have a class for Partners in Torah. As I mentioned before, the Partners in Torah Foundation, Baruch Hashem, reaches about 1,500 cities, if not more, every day during the week. And we also, Baruch Hashem, want to thank our sponsors and you all for being with us. Be'ezat Hashem, I want to thank Mr. and Mrs. Selwyn Isako. I want to thank the Partners in Torah Foundation and its members and sponsors. I want to thank our sponsor, Mr. and Mrs. Bernie Vezavid Baruch, and Narifan Alahem, and Narifan Alahem, to Mr. and Mrs. Yoni Harush, Atzlacha Be'ezat Hashem, Mr. and Mrs. Dani Almog, Needful, and Mr. and Mrs. Alex and Genya Leaf, and as usual, we'll do Refuah Shlema to Kol Cholam Chayisrael, first and foremost to Karen Bat Aliza. Be'ezat Hashem, Refuah Shlema, Atzlacha with the surgery, and everything will be good. Be'ezat Hashem, we also want to thank, and Refuah Shlema to Flori Bat Rachel, and Anat Bat Zizel, Shulamit Bat Sipora, Chaim Ben Raymond, Yachad Im Kol Chole Amacha Yisrael. Be'ezat Hashem, HaKadosh Baruch Hu Yirapeh Otam, El Na Refan Alahem, El Na Refan Alahem, El Na Refan Alahem. Alright, so, לעילו נשמת אבי מורי, ניסים, בן פרחי, אמי מורתי רחל, בת רוחמה, אחי, מאיר, אברהם ויעקב, ויחד עם כל חללי צבא הגנה לישראל, הקדוש ברוך הוא, בעזרת השם, יקום את דמם, וכמובן, לעילו נשמת חללי השואה והאיבה. פרשת ויחי is, by the way, is the last parasha of the Torah. We're going to finish the book of the Bereshit. When I say the last parasha of the Torah, last parasha of the book of Bereshit, Be'ezat Hashem, this book of Bereshit, just so you know, it's actually the period from creation to now, which, as we know, our world was created 5,781 years ago. And to date, Parashat Bereshit takes 2,289 years. In this parasha, we know that Yosef will be 56 years old, Yaakov will be 147 years old, and we see that right now this is the last year of Yaakov Avinu, Zichron Avracha, he'll be passing this year in the Torah. So we know the word Vayechi means, and Yaakov lived. So we know the Torah says that Yaakov lived in the land of Egypt 7 years. 17 years, and then he lived two kinds of life. He lived altogether 7 years, 40 years, and 100 years. The Torah, if you will notice here, the way the Torah lists the time of Yaakov on earth is from the smallest number, from the 7, then the 40, then the 100. Unlike Abraham, Yitzchak, Sarah, or the Torah list actually their life, first the 100, like in Sarah's case, 127, first the 100, then the 20, and then the 7. In Abraham is 100, then 70, then 5. And of course we see that with Yaakov is exactly the opposite. First is 7, then 40, and then 100. So for that there is explanation. Our sages explain that due to Yaakov complaining to Paro, when Yaakov came to Pharaoh 17 years ago in the Torah, he was 130 years old. And Pharaoh says, how old are you? And Yaakov complained using 33 words. And due to that complaint to Pharaoh, really about Hashem and his life, Hashem reduced 33 years from his life. For each word, 1 year was reduced. There's also the Ora Chaim HaKadosh, Rabbi Chaim Attar, says that HaKadosh Baruch Hu also has a world called measure for measure, right? One of the concepts of halakha and punishment and rewards, it comes from measure to measure. So measure to measure, when Yaakov Avinu was leaving the house of Lavan after 20 years with them, and Lavan chased him and said, somebody stole my idols. And we know Yaakov, not thinking that any of his, you know, either children or wives would do such thing, he says, whoever stole, lo yichyeh, shall die. The word yichyeh in numerical code is 33. And that's due to what he said. He actually shortened the life of Rachel. Rachel Imenu died when she was 36 years old due to Yaakov, for what of saying. And of course, we know here that Yaakov has been reduced 33 years from his life. And instead of 180, if we take 33 years off, he's 147. He actually, due to those two reasons, complaining using 33 words with Pharaoh and saying that whoever stole the idols from Lavan shall not live, 33 years were reduced from his life. We have to be very careful with our words. We don't understand really sometimes the power of speech is one of the most important things, because, you know, HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave us the ability to speak. You know, the Unkelus says that, you know, when we were breath, the breath of life by Hashem in the book of Bereshit, it really gave us part of the particles of God in us and the ability to speak. No other animal can speak like human and put sentences and think like human. So when we speak, we utilize the words of Hashem, the power of Hashem. And Hashem says in the Torah, "Betzelem Elohim barati oto," meaning that, you know, I gave you the ability to be godly. So we got to be very careful with the words that we do. And he says here that Yaakov lived 17 years in Egypt. So we know the word Vayechi, the first word of our parasha, in numerical code is 34, alluding to the real life that Yaakov considered living. The first 17 years were with Yosef, before he was sold to Egypt. 17 years, right? And now 17 years in Egypt, hence 34. He said, this is really my life, 34 years. We know the same thing happened with Sarah Imenu. When Sarah, Zichrona Livracha, in Parashat Chaye Sarah, it says, Vayushene Chaye Sarah. There are two kinds of life to Chaye Sarah. And in that, Vayehu, in numerical code, is 37. And Sarah really considered herself alive only when she had Yitzchak, until she passed. Sarah had Yitzchak when she was 90, and she passed at 127. Hence, she said, my life really was 37 years old. And we see that, as we mentioned, now Yosef is 56 years old. Yaakov is 147. And of course, Yaakov is now basically the Torah that he's going to end his life. Ve'ikravu yemei Israel lamut. So we know that the Torah says that until that moment, nobody knew when they're going to die. The only way they died in the old ways, before Yaakov, and the Gemara brings that, they were a sneeze. They would sneeze and they'll die. It says in the Gemara, for an example, Ela im haya otesh vehaya nishmato yotzet me'apo. The Gemara says that in the old days people sneezed and died. That's how they used to die. Only when Yaakov came, he asked Hashem to notify him a little bit before when he dies. And Hashem asked why. He says, I want to bless my children and I want to share my inheritance. You know, we know that Yaakov Avinu, the Zohar Kadosh says, because of that request, Hashem basically revealed to him the, not exact day or anything like that. Hashem does not reveal that to anybody except David HaMelech that dies on Shabbat. He asked, when will I die? And Hashem says, I'll not tell you. But he says, what day at least of the week? And Hashem says, okay, Shabbat. That's why David HaMelech does the meal of Melave Malka, the meal of Motzei Shabbat. At the end of Shabbat, there is a meal called Melave Malka. Hashem allowed David to know the day he'll die. And David HaMelech does this amazing, you know, thank you to Hashem, because he knows now this week he will not die. Guaranteed, because Hashem told him it will be Shabbat. That means maybe next Shabbat. So here Yaakov Avinu, as we know, the Zohar HaKadosh says, because of Yaakov requesting that, there is a neshama that joins a tzaddikim 30 days before they die, and they come. This neshama comes to help them leave this world. and come back to the other world. So he says, Yaakov Avinu says, Vayikravu yemei Yaakov lamut, Vayikra livno leYosef. So we know that Yaakov is about to die, but he doesn't call all his brothers, all his sons yet, I'm sorry. He calls Yosef. He says, the Torah adds another letter, Livno leYosef. Like there's two letters, Lamed and Lamed. So you know, when he was about to die, he understood the profound understanding of what Yaakov was really all about. So you know, Yaakov Avinu originally was destined to marry Rachel. None of the other three, you know, mothers that we had, Leah, Bilhah, and Zilpah. He was really destined to marry only Rachel. So he considered Yosef the Bechor. And as we know, the Bechor is in charge when the father passes away. So he called upon Yosef. You know, the two Lamed that we have, Lamed and Lamed, Levno, Le Yosef, to his son, to Yosef, in numerical code is 60, alluding to the sickness that he had. You know, when a person is sick, he has 60 parts. And we know when a person that visits a sick person, he takes one out of the 60 parts, elevate his neshama and help him, you know, regain life. So we know that he brought upon Yosef, he says, come, and I want to swear you, I want you to swear to me, if na matzati chen be'enecha, simna yachad tachat yarechi, yadcha, ve'asita imadi chesed ve'emet, and do not bury me in Egypt. So Yaakov Avinu is calling upon Yosef, because he understood only Yosef can really withstand and withhold this promise to bury Yaakov in the land of Israel. None of the other brothers could. Yosef is a king. In essence, what he was saying to him, I want you to promise me and make a vow. You know, in the old days, before Matan Torah, because, you know, the Torah will be given, you know, technically was already created before the world was created. As we know, the Gemara in Masechet Shabbat, in Tractate Shabbat 88.2, says that the Torah existed 974 generations prior to creation. And when we received it and we come upon it, you know, not now, but about, it will be almost 280 years from now or so, 290 years from now or so, when the people of Israel will go out of Egypt and they'll receive the Torah at the year 2448. Right now, Yaakov understands something amazing. He says, this is the only Bechor that we have, and he, not Reuven, he will be the one that can do what I'm asking to. And until Matan Torah, the swear was by the Brit Milah. The people used to swear to each other by the circumcision. Because what's the Brit Milah? The Brit Milah was the oath that was given. As we know, until the Torah was given, they would not swear by the Torah. They would swear by the oath of the circumcision. Because, you know, the entire book of Bereshit, there's only three mitzvot. Three good, you know, obligation that we have to do. Two are positive, one is negative. The two positive is first to have children, get married and have children. Prurvu. The second one was the Brit Milah, the circumcision by Abraham was obligated first. And of course we know when he was 99 years old. And the third one was not to eat the sciatic nerve. As we know, Yaakov fought the angel of Esav and he tried to hurt him. And the sciatic nerve is really where the Gemara says that's where Yetzer Hara reside, on the left side. And we know that Yaakov swears and make a vow with Yosef. And he says to him, do with me chesed and emet. Do with me kindness and true. So you know the word emet is a very interesting word. The word emet has the word Elohim and met. Right? Aleph is Elohim and met. Meaning that if a person that doesn't have Hashem in him is really considered dead. That's why the Gemara says that Rasha'im metim b'chayehem v'tzadikim chayim b'motam. The Gemara will tell us that the wicked are dead when they're alive and the righteous are alive when they are dead. Because really, after all said and done, when we give up Elohim, we consider almost a shallow of a human being. You know, hollow, shallow kinds of people. People that don't have Torah in them, they always have worries, always have Yetzirah, they have a lot of problems, you know, their children, everything is really catastrophe and chaos. You know why? Because there is no godly power in them. So, by the way, it says, do with me kindness and Emet. Emet is also the acronym of the three things that you need to take care of when you die. Aron, you need a casket. Met, mem, this is the death, ma, mita. And taf is tachrichim, is those, you know, linen sheets that you need to cover the body with. You know, to come to, you know, everything that has to do with Chevra Kadisha, so to speak. They do a lot of this, you know, process that Yaakov Avinu was asking for. So it says to him, I want you to bury me where my fathers are buried, right? Veshachavti mavotai, it says, bury me exactly where Abraham, Yitzchak, Adam, Arishon, you know, Me'arat HaMachpelah. This is really the essence of Yaakov promising to be buried exactly where he needs to be buried and not in any other place. Because, you know, Me'arat HaMachpelah, this is where Abraham Avinu purchased, and Yaakov will say that here too again, he purchased in the city of Hebron the Sadeh and the Me'arah from Ephron. And he knew, because, you know, that was really the burial of Abraham, of Adam Arishon and Sarah. And then, that, by the way, the word Machpelah, it's come from the word Kfilut, like duplication. There is four sets of tzaddikim that bury there, Adam and Chava. And then we have Adam and Eve. Then we have Abraham and Leah. Then we have Yitzchak and Rivka. And then, I'm sorry, Abraham and Sarah, Yitzchak and Rivka, and Yaakov and Leah. So now everybody's there except Yaakov. And that's why I said, Bekiv Ratam, Bekvuratam, meaning that when I'll be buried, there'll be the end of it. Tam mean end, right? That's why he says, Yosef, you know, when he promised to him, he knew exactly where to go, not any other place. Because that's really the end of the burial in Me'arat HaMachpelah. And Tam, meaning Met, and also the end. That's why the Torah describes Yaakov, Ish Tam Yoshev Ohalim. Tam is also Torah and Mitzvot. He was filled with Torah and Mitzvot. And he merited to be buried exactly with his forefather, so to speak. And of course, he asked him, he says to him to bury him there. Because we know Avraham Avinu, of course, Zichrono Livracha, was smart. He knew that one day, the people of Ishmael will lie and say, no, this is our land. No, I purchased. There are three things were purchased, just so you know. Avraham Avinu bought the Me'arat HaMachpelah. As we know, Yaakov bought Shechem, Nablus, and David HaMelech bought Yerushalayim. So in essence, they understood that these three locations in Israel will be, in the future, debated by the Arabs. And of course, it's all lies, so to speak, not to mention that, you know, there's no such thing, anything but the land of Israel. It's not the land of Ishmael. And you know, now you see many, many leaders in the Arab world starting to coming to, you know, the understanding that there was all BS and lies by the Arab world and no such thing as Palestinians. Al-Aqsa, by the way, just if you heard lately from Bahrain and from Saudi Arabia, they said to the Palestinians, what are you talking about? Al-Aqsa belonged to them. Al-Aqsa was actually none other than in Saudi Arabia before. It was never in Jerusalem. It's all lies. And of course, there is a cleric, one of the imam of Australia, that even says, you know, we, the Arabs, actually stole the Beit HaMikdash of the Jews. You admit to that. It's all, you know, lies and farce. But of course, we all know that. We don't have to have the Arabs tell us this. We don't have to have Trump, God bless him, tell us that, you know, Jerusalem is the capital of Israel. In essence, Yaakov, Avraham and Yosef, and David HaMelech, I'm sorry, ensured those three locations, because this is a very, very significant location to the people of Israel. Just so you know, the Zohar says that Me'arat HaMachpelah, where our, you know, patriarchs are buried in Hebron, this is the opening to heaven, and that's the tunnel that every neshama, when they pass, when the soul, the person pass, they always go through a dark tunnel, then they come out to the light. The dark tunnel is the tunnel that's in Me'arat HaMachpelah, and it goes out all the way to the light that comes out from Sha'ar HaShamayim, which is the Yerushalayim, Beit HaMikdash. That's where the neshama goes, first complain to Adam for their for his sin, and then throughout that they come out the neshama and then goes up to the light, also known as the place where Hashem will be judging the neshamot. And that's why the first thing that was created, as far as after the chaos in the world, Bereshit bara Elohim et hashamayim ve'et haaretz. First there was et, meaning the aleph through taf, the letters, the Hebrew letters, and the shamayim, then the land. But the first, the fourth thing that was created was the light, vayehi or, really the opening to heavens. This is where we always have to understand that at the end there's always light. There's a light at the end of the tunnel. And when we are about to leave this world, we have to ask Hashem, where are we going to be? How long are we going to be in the darkness versus the light? You know, the Gemara says we all have share in the world to come. The question is what share and how long will it take you to get there? It could take instantly if you're a good person and you fulfilled your life the way Hashem wants you to. Or chas v'chalila, it will take, I don't know, 100, 1,000, maybe more years in hell in the darkness until you come to the light. It's very important that for us every day ask this question before you leave the home. What kind of day are you going to bring upon you? Because when Hashem says, I'm opening the book, it really is your book. You write your own book. Every day is a page in your book. And what kind of, you know, written items will be there? What kind of things that you are going to record today? That's why the neshama goes up every day and records everything you've done during the day. So now Yaakov Avinu says, he says, Shavali, I want you to swear to me. So from here we learn, the Shulchan Aruch will tell us that if you don't have a swear, the agreement is not valid. And that's Yaakov Torah. For an example, when Yaakov purchased back the Bechora, the right to be the, you know, the nation of Israel, to do the Torah, to honor Hashem mitzvot, this is real, the real Bechora. This is the first right, so to speak. But he also purchased the right to marry Leah. She was the Bechora. And after he did all that, he fulfilled all the conditions with Esav, but at the end he says, Ishavan Ali, swear to me, Esav. And Esav did. And after he did all these four elements of, you know, discussing, paying for it, feeding him, signing a contract, so to speak, the shtar mechira, the certificate of purchase. And then he says, swear to me. By swearing, you guarantee this agreement. The Gemara will tell us in Shulchan Aruch, that was written by Rabbi Yosef Karo, Zichron Avracha, after he gathered all the halachot from the Gemara and made our life a lot easier, he says that if you don't have a swear, a contract could be void and null. So it's very important. Again, this is the Din Torah, not the contracts that we have around the world today in different laws and everything like that. So, of course, Vayishavalo, by the way, Yosef says, Vayomer anochi aseh kedvarecha. Yosef also says, I will do the same thing, Abba. I will bury you there, but I'll also be buried in the land of Israel. Anochi mean also me will do what you've said. As we know, Yaakov and Yosef, they were very much the same. There is the Gemara says they had 24 items exactly the same. And even the Ruach HaKodesh, they shared a lot of the Nevuot together. And it says, Vayishtachu, as we know, Vayishavah lo Vayishtachu Israel al Rosh HaMita. So we know that Yaakov Avinu, he was very sick. And again, that was literally days before he dies. And he was able to sit on the bed, you know, to swear. And he bow on the bed, not on the floor. He was on the bed. He wasn't even able to move from his bed. So we know that it says al Rosh HaMita. Why the Rosh HaMita is the one that's the mention here? So we know that the Shekhinah, the Zohar Kadosh says, the Shekhinah, the holiness reside on the head of the bed, meaning on the head of the person. And that's why Yaakov Avinu, when he gathered the 12 stones in the dream that he had in Har HaMoriah, the ladder, and he put 12 stones and they all became one, he understood the Shekhinah reside within his head, not his body. And that's really the spiritual part of us. And the Torah says, Vayichar advarim ha'ele, Vayomer leYosef, Hine avicha chole. So, you know, it was told after those things, the Torah says, after those saying, what was Acharei HaDvarim? So, as we mentioned before, until this moment, nobody died without sneezing. And only now the world understood that there is a different way of dying, and people will be also let have some of the us will have the opportunity to know that the death is coming upon us, so we can prepare accordingly. You know, the Gemara said that one of, if I'm not mistaken, Rabbi Yohanan, his student, asked him, Rabbi, how do we know we're going to die? He says, of course we know there's no date. You have to prepare every day. He said, like it's your last day. Every day should be our last day. That's what he taught them. And they say, ah, we understand now. So in essence, now Yaakov Avinu understand is about to die. And after he has the promise from Yosef, the people of the world heard Achar HaDvarim, especially the people of Egypt, says that, wow, Yaakov is about to die. This is abnormal. Usually people sneeze and die. They understood now there is a different way of dying. Vayomer Yosef, Hine Avicha Chole. So, you know, the question is, what's Hine? Why the Torah adds this word Hine? You could say, you know, it says, Vayomer Yosef, Avicha Chole. Father is sick. Why Hine? There it is, your father is sick. So the word Hine in numerical code is 60, alluding to the 60 part of sickness. When a person is sick, has 60 parts of sickness. And we know that Menashe came to his father and told him that, you know, Hine Avicha Chole, meaning that he's at a place that is almost dying now. And by the way, this is the first time in the Torah that the word sickness appears, chole. Until this moment, there was no sickness, as we mentioned. Everybody died instantly. There was no such thing as sickness, chole. Everybody was healthy as an ox. And when they died at their condition without sickness. Chole is an acronym, chutz leteva hadevarim. It's above nature. When a person gets sick, it's not because it's normal. It's because something wrong with their acts, their nefesh. The Zohar HaKadosh says when Hashem makes a person sick, they want him to reevaluate their lives and see why they're getting sick. What's going on? What have I done? What can I fix? And when we have chas v'chalila, something bad, it's not really bad. It's Hashem want us to be closer to him. You know, King Solomon says, remember Hashem when you're young, not when you're old or sick and when you need him. Yeah, of course, we all are healthy, rich, and you know, young, or whatever the case may be. We never thank Hashem as much as we beg him to help us when we need him. You should do just as much. You should beg Hashem when you're healthy, say thank you, and ask him to help you, to always watch over you. And you, really, the person is liable for their own health or sickness. The Zohar HaKadosh says, for an example, when we see the rainbow, right? Many people are like, wow, look at the beautiful rainbow and this, but it really, it's not a good thing for the world. Hashem remind us why the rainbow came. What's the rainbow? Is the destruction of the world in Parashat Noach, in the flood. Hashem, look at it. Hashem says, look, this is what I promised, not to destroy the world. There's problems in the world. The chaos that we have in the world today is really beyond belief. It's never been like this. Never in the history of the world we had such times. Only when the flood came and the world was destroyed. And what came after it? This rainbow to show us, remember, don't get to that place again. It's not a beautiful thing to look at. First, you know, the Zohar says, don't look at a rainbow. You're not allowed to stare at it. You can just look at it and that's it. But do not stare at the rainbow. It's really, in essence, is everything that was wrong about the world. So until this moment, nobody was sick. And when they came to Yosef, Menashe, by the way, Menashe and Ephraim used to study with Yaakov Avinu. Menashe is the word Mishnah. Yaakov used to teach him all the Mishnayot. And of course, Ephraim, we'll see later on, there is actually, it was a higher level than Menashe. And Vayikach et shnei banav imo, et Menashe v'et Ephraim. Yosef takes his Bechor, Menashe, and Ephraim, Menashe's name mentioned first, because he was the Bechor. And he was the one that's really, you know, Yosef considered, you know, is my Bechor, is the firstborn. Vayaged le'Yaakov vayomer hine bincha Yosef ba'elecha. So here we see a duplication almost of the word hine. First it was told hine that he's sick, and hine Yosef is coming. So now we have to understand from this, our sages explain that Yosef, because he would not, you know, wanted to, for one moment, Chas v'chalila, to upset his father with the sale of his brothers, of selling him to Egypt. He tried as little as possible to see his father. Because, you know, they're very much the same. They're very much, you know, some say the Gemara tell us in several places in the Zohar that Yaakov Avinu, of course, knew that Yosef is not dead. He didn't know where Yosef is yet, but he knew that Yosef is not dead. The proof to that is when they brought him the garment, Yaakov, the Gemara tells us that Yaakov saw no bites of any animal. You know, they told him it was attacked by a wild beast, Tarof Toraf Yosef. He looked at the garment, there's no hole in it, not even one bite mark. So he understood something is wrong here, and there was only blood on it. And it was the blood of a goat, you know, very much. Why goat? By the way, goat has the closest blood to human. It's the closest blood. The molecular level of the goat's blood and human is the closest out of all bloods. And we know we're not allowed to eat blood, right? Is the blood is the nefesh. So we see, continue here. So, Vayitchazek Yisrael vayeshev al hamita. So we know, we said that when you visit a sick person, you take one out of 60th of his sickness. As we say, hine is 60, hey nun hey. And hamita, we see here, hamita, it's 59, meaning that when Yosef came to visit, it took one out of the 60th sickness, and there's only 59. And Yaakov was able to sit on the bed, which he couldn't before. And he says, Vayomer Yaakov el Yosef, he says to him, El Shaddai, the word El and El, El Yosef and El Shaddai. Nira elai beluz, Yaakov is basically telling him that, you know, HaKadosh Baruch Hu came to me in Luz. Luz, by the way, just so you know, is the opening of heaven on earth. We don't see it. We know that Yaakov Avinu knew where it was. Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov knew where it was. Of course, King Solomon knew that. King Solomon, you know, well, Gemara will tell us that he actually transferred with time travel two Sofrim, two of his writers, to Luz when Satan wanted to kill them. And we know that Luz is really, because you know, the Torah says in Parashat Bereshit, when HaKadosh Baruch Hu created Adam and Eve, he says, Vayanichem began Eden Mikedem. And where is that? Here on earth. We just don't see it today. Our world, Olam. Olam comes from the word Ne'elam, meaning that it's not seen. There's many things we don't see in the world. For an example, you know, will come that when Yaakov Avinu is telling Yosef everything that's going to happen. He says, I want you to know the land of Israel will be Achuzat Olam. Forever will be the land of Israel for the Jewish people. The word Achuza means le'echoz, to hold by. You know, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, when he gave us the land of Israel, there was a condition to it. There is a, what we call, you know, according to the law of Hashem, if we don't, there is a stipulation, so to speak. If we don't honor Hashem, we're not capable of living in Israel. You know, before we lived in Israel, there was times almost 1400 years from Joshua until the second temple, there was literally almost close to 1500 years that we were in the land of Israel. And except, you know, when we had the second temple, when the first temple, I'm sorry, was destroyed, and we were in the Galut Bavel for 70 years when Nebuchadnezzar destroyed. We had the Mishkan Shiloh was 440 years in Israel, plus 40 years in the desert. The Mishkan, the tabernacle that Moshe built with Bezalel and Holy Hav. It was in Mishkan Shiloh, that was 440 years. And after that, they built the first temple, Temple of King Solomon, that was 410 years. And then they went out for 70 years. That's the story of Purim, by the way. That's the whole story of, you know, Bavel and Haman and Achashverosh, the whole, that's 70 years, and they came back. Ezra, Sofer, and of course, you know, Koresh sent them to build back the second temple. And the second temple stood for 420 years. So altogether, from Joshua to this, almost 1500 years, because why? We kept, in most cases, we kept Hashem's, you know, words and obligation. That's when we have Achuza. We can have a hold on the land of Israel. But when we're not, Chas v'chalila, we go against Hashem, against each other, when we have sinat chinam, and when we do, chas v'chalila, crimes, you know, against humanity, crimes against ourselves. Hashem throw us, it says that Hashem really is almost like throwing up the people of Israel out of Israel. And that's exactly what happened until today. The Galut, for an example, even though we have the land of Israel today, you know, since 1948 back, it doesn't mean that we have really achieved everything. It's just we achieved a partial hold on Israel, because today still you have millions that not, you know, Jewish people in Israel that should not be there. And we don't have the temple. So it's really exile until the third temple will come and be built, you know, come ready and be placed on Yerushalayim. Until that moment, we're still in exile, even though we have the land of Israel. And we could easily lose this land. You know, today you see the chaos in the world, that, you know, between China and not to mention Russia and not to mention Iran and everything. Those are really real threats. And, you know, more than 90% of Europe hate Israel. It's very possible that we can lose the land of Israel. Chaz v'chalila, chaz v'chalila, if we don't change our ways. But Yaakov says it will be forever. Even though if you're in and out, it will be achuzat olam. But you have to hold by it. You have to have the right to hold it, to be there. And we see here, basically what Yaakov is doing here is transferring the ability to bless. Because, you know, Abraham transferred it to Yitzchak. Yitzchak transferred it to Yaakov. And now Yaakov is transferring it to Yosef. And we know that Yosef will transfer it later on before he dies. And he says, after all said and done, he says to him, I want you to know the two children that you have. And Yaakov changed now the way they appear in the Torah, Ephraim first and Menashe, Lihem, they will be for me. Meaning the Zohar Kadosh says in the Arizal in Gilgul HaNeshamot that really Ephraim and Menashe were supposed to be born to Yaakov. But what happened is that's why the Torah says he'll be like Keruven v'Shimon Yihuli. They'll be like Reuven and Shimon. So we know Reuven and Shimon and Ephraim and Menashe is very much the same in the Merkel code except one. Ephraim and Menashe, if I'm not mistaken, is 732. And Shimon and Ephraim is, Reuven and Shimon is 731. So the Zohar says, Yaakov says, this is really part of the 12 tribe that I was promised. Because, you know, the 12 tribes, we know Levi is not considered one of the tribes. It does not have Nachala b'Israel. The Levi is the tribe that actually is for Hashem. Levi is Veli, right? It's for me. When Hashem, you know, allowed to have the 13th tribe, one of them will be serving both Hashem and the people of Israel. By the way, the Levites had no tax, right? They didn't have to pay taxes. That's why there is, in America, for an example, it says tax levy. What's tax levy? Tax levy is from the Levites. They didn't have to pay tax. There are certain things, like when you have a foundation that is non-profit, you have a tax levy on it, for an example. So this is the Levites' non-taxable item. It's very interesting how the Torah works. Everything, from, of course, from earth has come from the Torah. So we know that his Yosef wants Yaakov to bless them. And the way Yosef brings the children is brings Menashe on the right hand of Yaakov and Ephraim on the left. But we know that Yaakov Avinu crosses his hands and he put the right hand on Ephraim and the left on Menashe. And we know that Yosef was not happy with this. And he says, well, Abba, what are you doing? You know, ויקח יוסף את שניהם בימינו, it says, put it Ephraim בימינו, משמאל ישראל. As I mentioned, Ephraim will be on the left side of Yaakov, of Israel. By the way, when it comes to the name Israel, just so you know, first it was introduced when the angel changed the name for Yaakov to Israel. By the way, the word Israel is Yashar El. We have to be straight with Hashem, and then Hashem will be Rosh Eli. That will be the heads for ourselves. We'll be basically deserving of Him. And when Yaakov Avinu was placing the hand on Ephraim on the right and then changing on the left to Menashe, is because he understood something. Because, you know, the word Israel is only used three times. From the moment the brothers sold Yosef, the Torah records the name Israel only three times when it comes to Yaakov. Hence, that really Yaakov knew that something is wrong. He says, don't call me Israel. our children are not straight. They're not Yashar El. Something is going on here. And that's why only at the end it's mentioned with Yaakov three times. Why? Because it's really the three times of the Beit HaMikdash. The first, the second, and the third will be the final one. So we know that Yosef was very adamant about his father not to do it. You know? And he even asked Yaakov, "Vayomer Yosef el aviv, lo ken aviya." You know, this is not the right way. My Bechor is Menashe. And my younger one is Ephraim. What Yosef was saying to Yaakov, he was saying to him, "My dear father, we all know what happened before. Every time, from day one, every time that the young one was blessed more, the brothers either hated him or killed him." And the Zohar Kadosh brings, it says that Yosef said to Yaakov, to Israel, it says, look, from creation, HaKadosh Baruch Hu had Cain and Hevel. Cain was the Bechor, and Hevel was the young one. But Hevel, you know, did better work with Hashem. Hashem loved him more than Cain. And Cain murdered Hevel. By the way, just a side note, Cain was the person that lived the longest in the history of the world. Cain lived 1,500 years until the flood almost. You know, Lamech killed Cain. That was 1,500 years into creation before the Mabul, 100 years before the Mabul. And Hashem was willing to even forgive a murder, you know. And Cain did a real tshuva. The Zohar says that he did such a tshuva that he merited to live 1,500 years. But Yosef saying, look, Cain murdered Hevel. And then look what happened with Avraham. Avraham had Ishmael and Yitzchak. Ishmael wanted to murder Yitzchak. And then, of course, you know, your father Yitzchak and your mother Rivka had Esav and Yaakov. Esav wanted to kill Yaakov. Please don't bless Ephraim, and I don't want Menashe to hate him and kill him. And Yaakov says to him something amazing. Yaakov says, Yadati beni yadati. I know, my son, I know. In essence, what Yaakov was saying to Yosef, I know what he's saying, but I also know something else. The word beni, Yaakov, as we mentioned, he would actually question, who are these children when Yosef brings to him? He says, who are those? Because Yaakov, as we know, the Zohar says he had the knowledge of the Parzufim. He was a prophet and he could see to the end of creation of this world, meaning 6,000 years. And throughout the generation, he saw things that were coming from these two children. He says, who are these children, Yosef? And Yosef says, this is the children Hashem gave me. So Yaakov says, Yadati beni yadati. I know, my son, I know. Meaning, I know what's about to happen here. He says, I see them, yes, but I also see the future children that will come from them. You know, Beni is Rashi Tevot, Yoshua Binun. You know, and then Beni is also Rashi Tevot, is the acronym of Yeravam ben Navat, and it's also Yehu ben Shnuya. So we know that Yosef did not know who are the children that Yaakov was speaking about. He was talking about the future, because you know Yeshua was great, but we know that of course Yeravam ben Nevat was horrific, and Achav, that wanted to kill Eliyahu Navi, was horrific. And of course he saw, I see those bad children coming from your children, but I also good. I know, my son, I know. In essence, what Yaakov was revealing, you know, the lineage of Yosef. And we know that in the future, by the way, Yeravam ben Nevat was the one that actually split the nations of Israel, the 10 and 2 tribes. When he went, you know, against Yeravam, did not want the son of Shlomo HaMelech, King Solomon, Rechavam, to be the ruler of Israel. So he put a blockage on the way to Yerushalayim, and he built his own temple, and he would not allow people to go to Beit HaMikdash. And he took 10 tribes, and because of that, those 10 tribes disappeared from the world. By the way, the Gemara says that these 10 tribes are hidden behind the river Simbation. There is a river called Simbation. It's very amazing, you know, the Zohar says, it's according to also in the Gemara, I brought that in the Gemara said this river is called Simbation. It's where the 10 tribes are hidden. We don't see them. And it's a river that actually throughout the week, there's no water in it. It's, you know, only rocks, giant rocks, small rocks, big, medium rocks flow through it the whole week. And only on Shabbat it stops and rests. And they finally found this river. There's a river in India. You can look it up on Rabbi Google. Just type Simbation. Simbation River in Hebrew or in English. And it's they found, and there is a video of it showing exactly what the Gemara said 1600 years ago. It spews only rocks, flows rocks during the week. On Shabbat it stops, a little bit of water comes out. But rocks don't come on Shabbat. Every week, every day, it flows rocks. Very incredible. So, as we know, now he blesses Ephraim and Menashe. And by the way, that moment in time, and the reason that Yaakov says, I know, my son, I know, he also revealed to him, I want you to know, this is the best children one can have. You manage to have the first children in the world, brothers, that has such love for each other and admiration that's forever and ever will we use them to bless others. So we know we have what we call Birkat HaBanim. Birkat HaBanim is the blessing that we do for our children. Every Friday night after Kiddush, we do something amazing. You know, we take our hands, we put both our hands on our children. First on the boy, you have to do it on the son first. And we say, from here, it comes in the Torah, by the way. It says here, Yaakov Avinu said to Yosef, Le'emor, Becha yevarech Israel. Meaning in those two children, Le'emor, Yisimcha Elohim ke Ephraim uche Menashe. Vayasem et Ephraim lifne Menashe. So, you know, because of these two children, I said that Menashe, even though Yaakov changed his hands, meaning changing their position in life, changing their whole knowledge of what they knew until today, and revealed to them that they're really the most amazing children that can bless the entire children of Israel because of their names. So on Friday night after Kiddush, we put our hands on our son and we say, Simcha Elohim, Elohim ke Ephraim ke Menashe, Hashem places you and puts you in a place at the level of Ephraim and Menashe. You know, when Yaakov Avinu did that, Menashe was so happy for Ephraim that he also blessed him as well. And that's the most beautiful thing you can have when sons, children, brothers love each other so much. There's a story in the Gemara about two brothers like this that had a field, and every night a brother will get up and make the field of his other brother a little bigger and longer, and it will move the fence from side. And one night they woke up and they saw each other doing the same thing, and they realized how much they love each other. This is Ephraim and Menashe. Ephraim and Menashe had such love for each other. They were so happy for each other. They always, always want each other's best at heart. And that's why we bless our children like this. For our daughters, we bless with our foremothers. You know, as we know, we say, Yesimech HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Ke Sara, Ke Rivka, Ke Le'o, Ke Rachel. Those are our foremothers, you know, that in essence give us the blessing. So we see the two children are really Birkat HaBanim. This is where Yosef was managed to even be in Egypt, to raise the best children out of all our forefathers. That's why Yosef called Yosef HaTzadik. Many reasons, but this is one of the reasons. When Yaakov says, Mi ele, who are they? He says, how can you manage to have such children in the worst place in the world? You know, Egypt is the most devastating place of Tumah and Gilui Arayot and murder, everything that is worse in mankind was in Egypt. Only because Hashem promised not to destroy the world, he did not bring a flood on Egypt. Instead, he brought the 10 plagues. That's in lieu of the flood. And he saw that everything with the 10 plagues started from the bottom all the way up, from underneath the ground, from the water, from the blood, all the way to Makat Bechorot, all the way to kill the firstborn. Really, everything in creation was destroyed in Egypt. In essence, and in lieu of the Mabul. But you know, Yaakov Avinu was so enamored and impressed with those two children. That's why he said to Yosef, how did you manage to do this? Mi ele? Who are they? How can you be that you are in a worse place to teach us something amazing? Wherever we are in the world, wherever Hashem brought us to, don't ever ask why. No matter where you are in the world, you could be here in San Diego, you could be in Morocco, you could be in Afghanistan, you could be in wherever you are, ask why Hashem placed you there. There should be one answer: to collect the sparks of Kedusha. The Zohar Kadosh says, wherever Hashem placed you, there is no coincidence, there is no, why am I here? It's what I can do for the Jewish people all over the world in my little, you know, piece of earth. What is the essence of a Jewish person? That's why Hashem says you'll be like the stars, but you also be like the sand. You know, the sand can never be like the sand physically, right? If you go to the beach and you pick up one scoop with a tractor of sand, there's not enough juice to fill that kind of number. But in essence, what Hashem was telling us, you'll be on every sand around the world, around beaches of the world. You know, the world is an island. Originally, it was one piece that broke after the Mabul. We have our continents, but really, it's surrounding every, it's by ocean. And the sand that we are like the people that spread all over the world. And we are there to not, chas v'chalila, you know, complain why we're here. This is what for? What can we do to really fulfill the blessing of Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov? It says, be like the stars, even though you feel like the sand that people steps on you. It's very interesting, you know, the water of the world is 72%. The earth is 28%. And forever and ever, the ocean can never take over the sand. It can move it from one side to another, but it could never take over. That's what Hashem says. You, the Jewish people, will be pushed against all kinds of corners in the world, by all kinds of so-called waves and hurricanes and you name it. But really, in essence, you are there to do what Hashem wants you to do all over the world. It says why? Because when Adam Arishon, when Hashem created Adam, he took 7 steps all over the world. That's it. 7 steps. That's how big he was originally before the sin. 7 steps alluding to the 7 continent. And of course, alluding to where we will be in the future. So we are all come from Adam Arishon. Every one of us, the Jewish people, is sparks of Adam Arishon that was actually, you know, after the sin was spread all over the world. And we are there. And now Yaakov Avinu, after he blesses Ephraim and Menashe, he called upon the 12 tribes. And it says, "Vayikra Yaakov el bana, vayomer ha'asfu v'agid lachem et asher ikra etchem be'acharit hayamim." So Yaakov gathers the 12 tribes now. So in essence, what Yaakov does, he places the order of the tribes around his bed, exactly we have on the 4 corners of the world, north, east, west, and south. That's, by the way, the word news acronym. He places 3 on the north, 3 on the south, 3 on the west, and 3 on the east. And in the middle, him. This is how the children of Israel, after they leave Egypt, the 12 tribes will travel in the desert 40 years. The middle will be the Kahuna, around the Levites, which is the 13th tribe within, and the 12 tribes around. And that's Shevet al Diglo, each tribe on his flag, but it's also Diglo is Godlo, how they are in according to their size, both in physical numbers and in spiritual numbers, levels. So we know that Yaakov, before he can bless, he says, let me tell you the end of days. Acharit hayamim, by the way, meaning the end of days. But, by the way, just so you know, the word acharit hayamim mentioned in the Torah 3 times, one in Bereshit, one here, you know, in Parashat Vayechi, and one in Divrei Hayamim in the Bible. And we know that Yaakov, when he gathered them, he asked them, are you guys united? Before he could, because all of a sudden he lost his prophecy. He wanted to tell them the end of the day, the Ketz Hayamim, and he could not. So he asked them, are you guys united? And here, by the way, is the first time it's not written in Torah, but the brothers said to Yaakov, Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Listen, Yaakov, you know, Israel is the name of Yaakov. Hashem is our God and we are united as one. And Yaakov Avinu then were able to pursue and give them the blessings. Even though Yaakov Avinu did not really bless Shimon, if you read carefully, you see, so he blessed Reuven, but when it comes to Shimon Velevi, he does not bless them. He says, Kle Hamas, you are basically Chaz v'Chalila, what you did in Shechem. By the way, we skipped a little bit, but when Yaakov revealed to Yosef where he'll be buried, he says, Shechem, I bought it. It's for you. That's where you'll be buried. Because, you know, Yosef was stolen from Shechem and sold to the Egyptian. And he said, bring my bones back to Shechem. Mishchem lukachti v'shchem akaver v'ta'orer b'tchiyat ha'metim. Said that he knew exactly why he wanted to be buried in Shechem. That's where he was left when he was looking for his brother. They sold him. And that's where he wants to be buried in the future. And we know that Yaakov Avinu blessed the brothers, each one in its own way. But he also rebuked some of them, like we mentioned with Shimon and Levi. Kelecha mas mechorotem. He said, wow, what you did to me, killing the 24,000 in Shechem, which is, you know, where Dinah was raped. He says, yes, you've done it, but it's actually also, it's very, very, it's a curse to us. And we see today what happened in Shechem. We can't even go to Kever Yosef. Shechem was always problematic for Israel. Even from the stories of Dinah and the 24. And when Yaakov also lost Yosef. But in essence, that's also where the 10 tribes would live from. From Shechem and will be hidden behind this river Simbation. So in essence, we see Yaakov give the blessing to the brothers, and each one its own way. And of course, he gives Yehuda is the lion, Ariyeh, and Yosef is the shore, is the axe, alluding to days of Mashiach. You know, there'll be Mashiach ben David, come from Yehuda, and Mashiach ben Yosef, there's an axe and a lion. You know, Ariyeh in Hebrew, if you rearrange the letters, Yirah, is fear. Yehuda, as we know, was the king of Israel. The word Yehuda has the letters of Hashem, all four of them, and Dalet for David, King David, will come from him. And in the numeral code, it's 30, alluding to when King David will become a king. He will be 30 years old. And as we know, David HaMelech will be king first in Hebron for 7 years, and after that will be 33 years in Yerushalayim. And he will start the foundation of Beit HaMikdash, digging the hole, 150 amot for the blood, for all the korbanot. Gemara will tell us the story about it. We can talk about it later. In the meantime, it says that Yaakov kednasi de ketz. What's ketz? Ketz means the end, but it's also Yaakov was revealing a secret to the people of Israel. Because we mentioned now Yosef is 56 years old. Right, he will die at 110. Here it says that in the Torah in a minute. But Yaakov says, I want you to know, after Yosef will pass, you'll be in Galut as the slavery that was promised originally to Avraham 400 years is really, I want you to know about the Ketz. Ketz in the numeral code is 190. Kuf and Tzadik, Kuf is 100, Tzadik is 90. Yaakov says, I want you to know, you will not be working for slave for 400, it will be only 210. If we take 400 minus Ketz, 400 minus 190 is 210. And only that you'll be in Egypt, not 400. What Yaakov is saying is thanks to Yitzchak. Yitzchak Avinu, you know, he was born exactly on Pesach, the 15th of Nisan, 2048. The Jewish count. And we came out of Egypt 400 years later, meaning that we not were slaved for the 400 years. We were slaved or in Egypt technically for 210 years. And if we take from the birth of Yitzchak to coming out of Egypt, when do we came out of Egypt? It was the 15th of Nisan, Pesach, 2448, exactly 400 years from the birth of Yitzchak. Yitzchak, you know, as we know, he was the one that never left the land of Israel. Abraham did, Yaakov did. He was born in Israel and died in Israel. Abraham was born outside of the land and buried in Israel. Yaakov was born in Israel, was, you know, came out to Egypt and went back. When Yaakov Avinu is dying here, he says, "Vayomer lehem ani ne'asaf el ami kivru oti el avotai el ha'me'ara asher bisde Efron ha'chiti." So we know again, Yaakov is specific about where to be buried. The Gemara will tell us, and it's we'll mention here slightly, that when they brought Yaakov to be buried, first they had 70 days in Egypt. You know, there were the so-called Chantu, you know, there were what we call the, you know, the embalmed Yaakov Avinu, like they do with every king in Egypt. And then they spent 30 days of mourning. 70 days he was in Egypt before he was brought up to be buried in Me'arat HaMachpelah. And when they came, masses and masses of military and generals and all kinds of Egyptian came out to, you know, escort his, what we call, casket after 70 days. Those 70, by the way, is against the 70 nefesh that came out to Egypt. When Yaakov left Israel and came down to Egypt 17 years ago, according to this count, he came out with 70, 66 with him and 4 with Yosef. As we know, Yosef was not Ephraim and Menashe, 70. So each day they mourn for this nefashot that will remain behind and will then will come out, in, as we mentioned, in 210 years after Yosef dies. So now it says that when they brought him, the people, of, you know, the settlers that took over the land of Israel and waiting for, you know, for us to come back to it, all the nation were terrified. They thought it was a war. But then they see the ketel. There was a crown on the casket of Yaakov, and they understood that this is really a much holier event than a war. And they actually joined the mourning for Yaakov. And the whole world really mourned for Yaakov 7 days. Because, you know, when Yaakov came to Egypt, it says, "Vayivarech et Paro." What did he bless Paro? He blessed Paro that the famine, because, you know, Yaakov came to Egypt 2 years into the famine. And Yaakov blessed Paro, and the famine was actually postponed 17 years. And the whole world benefited from it. And but then only the 12 children would carry the casket of Yaakov into Me'arat HaMachpelah. Of course, Levi cannot touch it. Levi has to be holy at all times. And when they get there, Esav is actually not allowing them to bury Yaakov. And he start contesting this. He said, "No, Yaakov cannot be buried here. He was not here for 36 years, did not respect his parents," all kinds of claims. There was a child named Hushim. Hushim was the son of Dan. Hushim saw this whole commotion. The Gemara tells us that he was a little slow, but he saw this commotion and his grandfather standing there on his casket, you know, and Esav would not let him in. He took a sword and he cut the heads of Esav. And really, in essence, this is the prophecy of Rivka saying to Yaakov that you'll both be buried in the same day. And that's exactly what happened. The Gemara says that the head of Esav rolled into Me'arat HaMachpelah, to down to the legs, the feet of Yitzchak, and they buried it in there. 100%, I'm not sure, but this is what the Gemara says. And if the Gemara says, I know it's 1,000,000%. And then they buried Yaakov, and of course we know that then after that, Vayasef el Amav, you know, when we are dying, you know, from Yaakov, we learn this amazing terminology of what does it really mean that we are Vayasef el Amav. So, you know, the Torah says, what's Vayasef? The Zohar says Vayasef is to gather. Right before we die, what do? We gather everything that we've done in the world, everything that we've done, from mitzvot, chas v'chalila, to sins. And then El, what are we doing? We're going towards Hashem now. We're coming towards HaKadosh Baruch Hu to be sentenced. And says, Amav, we actually come to see all our Gilgulim and all our family, everybody that we, from day one, when our Neshama was given to us from Adam HaRishon until that moment, all your people, your family, your relative will come and welcome you. The Zohar Kadosh says, Kemo shenolad umishpachto, מקבלת אותו בעולם הזה, כך משפחתו מקבלת אותו בעולם הבא. So it says, just like your family received you when this came to this world, everybody wait for the baby, there's a big commotion, the simcha for a daughter, the brit milah for a son, your family, friends, everybody come to welcome you. This, the same thing happened on the other side. When we leave this world, the entire family that passed already, the family that was reincarnated, everybody come to welcome you. That's why when a baby comes to this world, is not happy, cries all the time, and the hands are closed and clutched. They don't want to leave where they came from. But when we die with our hands open. We don't want to take anything from this world. The only thing we can take with us is the mitzvot. So we know the Torah now comes and speak about Yosef. And you know, the Torah says, and I'll finish in about 5 minutes, forgive me for going over the time here. But it says that after all said and done, when the brothers and Yosef, after they buried their father, come back to Egypt, the Zohar says that Yosef stopped in two places. He stopped at Kever Rachel, you know, as his father says, Meta Alai Rachel, meaning Alai, it's because of me Rachel died. As we know, we mentioned Rachel died when she was 36 years old. She was the youngest of the four mothers. And because, Yaakov says, Lo Yichye, she lost her life. He lost 33 years from his life. So Yosef went to mourn for his mother. You know, the Zohar says that his mother, until today, cries for her children to come back. Why? Because she died giving birth. You know, she died giving birth to Binyamin. And we know that it says that Rachel mevaka et baneha, she always cried for her children to come, and Hashem promised her, Mini kolech mibechi, stop crying, I promise you, you will, all the children will come back to, you know, when they come back, they will come where you are, and there will be tchiyat amitim, you'll see them all coming in. And Yosef, in essence, went to that to guarantee this promise. And he went to the grave of his mother, and then he went somewhere else. He went to the same hole that his brother threw him in. Habor. The Zohar HaKadosh says Yosef went there and actually prays and says, Baruch Ata Hashem Elokeinu Melech HaOlam She'asa Lanu Nes. He says, you, there is halacha. When you have a place, a miracle happen to you, you have to go and bless the place for doing a miracle for you. And Yosef went there. The brother, on the other hand, thought the other way. They thought that Yosef is going to now revenge. That's why it says here, Vayer'u ache Yosef kimet avihem, Vayomru lo, Istemenu Yosef, Vehashev yashiv lanu et kol hara'a asher gamalnu oto. The brother thinks that Yosef is going to revenge now. And they understand this is really a payment about to come because of all the bad they did to him. Vayitzavu el Yosef le'emor avicha tziva lifnei moto. The brothers lies. They're sending a messenger to Yosef saying, your father commanded that you will not hurt us. First and foremost, it's not true. Yaakov never said that. Second, how can the brother have the so-called audacity to do such thing? So the Zohar HaKadosh says actually they were allowed for the shalom bayit, for the peace in the family. Sometimes you're allowed to lie. We know that from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. When in Parashat Lech Lecha, when Hashem revealed to Abraham that he's going to have a son, Katuv Yitzchak Avraham, Avraham laughed, and then he said to Hashem, what about Sarah? So you know, when Hashem, the angel said to Sarah that you're going to have a child, she also laughed. But she said something. She said, my husband is old. When Hashem came to Abraham, Abraham says, what Sarah said? Hashem changed it. Hashem says, you are both old. This is really a white lie for Shlom Bayit. HaKadosh Baruch Hu did not want Avraham Chas V'Chalila to, you know, even be upset with his wife. That's why we have one korban. There is a sacrifice called Chatat LaHashem. It's a sin that Hashem did, Chet, but it was for Shlom Bayit. The brothers here do the same thing because they don't want a Chas V'Chalila destruction. So they lie. This is Yaakov. Asked that, you know, he commended. You know, the Zohar Kadosh says that they sent Bilha. They sent Bilha to ask for this. That's why it says, Kotomru le Yosef. And you know, after that, Vayelchu gam echa vayplu lefanav. Vayamru hinenu lecha la'avadim. They went there and they said, we are your servant. They never apologized for what they did. Hence, the Gemara explained that when Yosef saw them in the first time, he says, Meraglim atem, you are spies. In essence, he saw that they will pay for the sin, both of the spies that will die in the desert. There will be the Gilgul of the spies, the reincarnation of the 10 spies that will die and buried in the desert, will be punished for 40 years. And he also saw that there will be the 10 Haruge Malchut, the 10 righteous people that will be killed by Adrianus, the Roman Caesar. And he cried for them. Vayivech Yosef bedabram elav. The Torah says in Parashat Vayeshev, I'm sorry, Parashat Vayigash, that he cried upon them. Who are them? Alehem. Alehem is acronym. Atidim lihyod haruge malchut. He saw the prophecy that they're going to die. Why? Because they never really apologized for what they did. When you make a mistake, you did a sin, you say, I'm sorry, Hashem. First you recognize, then you vidui, you confess, and then you receive Kabbalah not to do. They never did that. But Yosef was so adamant more, and he cried also, Vayomer alehem Yosef, al tirau, ki atachat Elohim ani. Says, how can you be so fearful? Don't you know I'm, you know, under Hashem all the time? I never left Hashem, even when he sold me. I was always a Hebrew boy, Na'ar Ivri. The Torah mentioned that. I never told my father. 22 years, I never told him. He was here for 17 years with me. I never told him. How dare you think that I'll do such thing? And he says to them, even though chashavtem alai ra'a, Elohim chashva letova. Even though you did something bad, Hashem, at the end, will bring it out good. There's no such thing as bad. Rabbi Akiva says, Hakol letova. Everything is for good. We just don't know it yet. But we'll see at the end that everything that happened, even bad things that we think are bad, they're not really bad. They're actually great. We just, at that moment, we don't have the foresight to understand how great they are. We think it's bad. The word ra in Hebrew means also rea, a friend, and also air, to waken you up. And we know that Yosef, basically, he lived 110 years, the Torah said. We mentioned that he actually was supposed to live 120, but he lost 1 year for every Lashon Hara spoke about his brother. And he also lost 10 years because when the brother came to look for food, they keep saying, Yaakov, your servant, Avdecha Yaakov. And Yosef not for once stopped them for saying he's a servant. He could have said, what are you talking about? Don't talk about your father like that. He never said that. And that's part of the 10 years he lost. And as we know, Yosef now make the same vows with the brother. Says, Hashem will remember you. Remember, 210 years from now will come out when Yaakov says, Redu Shama. Redu in Gematria, go down there, is 210. Shama is Moshe, will bring you out. He said, promise me that when we come out of Egypt, you take my bones and bury it in Shechem. וישבה יוסף את בני ישראל אמור פקוד פוקד אלוהים אתכם ועליתם את עצמותיי מזה. What's מזה? From here. But מזה, the Baal HaTurim says, is from זה. זה first is 12 in the numerical code. He says, I'm part of the 12 tribes. Remember that always, even though you did not wanted me to be. But also, I want you to know, I managed throughout the whole event, is to always be respectful of the two commandments out of the Ten Commandments. All of them I kept, but two I kept more than anything else. Ze is lo tinaf, the seventh commandment. And hey, kabed et avicha ve'et imecha, respect your parents. I've done those the most. And just because of those, I'm married to be buried in Israel. And that's exactly what happened. Ve'vayasim be'aron be'mitzrayim. They put Yosef in a metal casket, the Torah says. The Gemara will tell us that the Egyptian, after they embalmed his body, they put him in a metal casket that weighed 500 kikarot. 500 kikarot is almost 1,500 kilos. And they threw it into the Nile, in the depth of the Nile, so the Nile will be blessed by him. And we know that Moshe Rabbeinu, the Ra'on, will bring about. So again, thank you so much for being with us. I'm Rabbi Dahan for Kol Ravat Israel Partners in Torah Foundation, San Diego chapter. I want to again thank Mr. and Mrs. Selwyn Isaacle. Thank all of you for being with us. Please share this class, and it will be posted on our website at neshatorah.org, and also on our YouTube and Facebook. And I thank you all for being with us. Have a wonderful rest of the week. Join us tomorrow, please.